We began a study. It's hard to believe. This was clear back at the beginning of the year, looking in Psalm 18. In case you haven't picked up on it, we're trying to focus all year long on prayer. And I had an emotional spiritual experience before church. Laura asked if she could meet me for just a few minutes before church. And she's been working and has put together, see if I can show it to y'all here without making a mess. She's put together a packet going into Easter that says, "Because He lives." And as a result of Jesus living for us, and it says underneath that, interceding for our community and for our church. And the Lord's directed her to come up with 11 cards: salvation, deliverance, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, provision in our life, healing in our life, restoration for our life, favor upon our life, fruit that will remain, protection over our life, signs and wonders for our church, and power for us as believers. How many know those are all good topics? And with each and every one of those, the Lord's directed her to come up with scripture portions that we can take these cards and pray over these. If we don't know how to pray, we can just take them and say, "Lord, I'm going to pray these scripture right now for power in my life," or salvation in 46802, and for signs and wonders to be manifested in our church. And she's going to make these, we're going to talk more about them, but the Lord's given her an entire program. Will you just mark this down? Will you write down February the 19th? And begin praying with us, because Laura is going to present not a program, but a ministry in our church of what the Lord's laid on her heart. And we're going to be presenting it in detail on that Sunday morning if the Lord tarries, and asking people to join us. How many know that we thank the Lord that we got out of the bondage of denominationalism and all of what that represents? But I also think that sometimes in our throwing the dirty bathwater out, we got rid of the baby too. And there were some blessed things. One of those is Lent. I know it can become a form, but you know what? If we do it as unto the Lord, it can have power in it. And the 6 weeks of Lent, we're going to be challenging all of us at Calvary Christian Fellowship to participate in something that I believe will bring blessing to the church, bring blessing to our families, bring blessing in our personal lives, and I believe it'll bless the kingdom of God and expand it. Will you pray with us that we can present that on February the 19th, and God will just give favor to Laura in that presentation, and the anointing will be upon it, and conviction will be here that people will participate in what we're going to be challenging us to do during those days. Can I share something else that's just on my heart before we go to the Word of God? Today when I got home and laid down just for a few minutes and then began to prepare my heart for tonight, there was something that was on my heart. I didn't share it, didn't tell anybody else, and just got ready and got in the car with Andrew as we were driving into church. And while we were riding, out of just absolutely, quote-unquote, nowhere, coincidentally, Andrew just began to talk about something that was heavy on his heart. And how many know that when all of a sudden there's the mouth of two or three witnesses of something, you better pay attention to what the Lord's wanting to say. And let me share what both of us had as an experience today that was on our heart. Do you know that if this morning just the people that name Calvary Christian Fellowship as their church were to show up? I'm not talking about just occasional people. The people that, if you went to them and you were to say, "Hey, where do you go to church?" this is where they would say they belong. The problem is they weren't here. And if they had, do you know that we would have had over twice the amount of people in God's house than what we're here this morning? That's amazing. We would have had twice as many chairs than what were set up, and they would have all been filled. And that's the figure. Andrew deals with that every day. That's what his ministry is in our church. And he said, Dad, it was staggering to me to realize I'm not talking about people that just every so often drop by or people that, you know, once we're apart that aren't here anymore and we're still trying to think about, are they going to show up? These are regular people. And all of a sudden it came out of Andrew's mouth, and it was what was on my heart. We don't do a lot of mailing with all of a sudden the social media. We don't have to do all of that expense of mailing anymore. But will you pray with me? I want to write a letter, and I want to set a Sunday, and I want to make it a personal letter, not a form letter. So it's going to take a little while, because I want to say some things to each one of the people privately of challenging them on a given Sunday. Wouldn't it build your faith to all of a sudden look and go, wow, so-and-so isn't here anymore, to look and to see who really are a part of the camp. And let's challenge them to come and be here on one Sunday. And maybe if they caught a vision of that, they would be able to be more faithful every Sunday to God's house. How many will agree with me and pray about that? Can I challenge us about one other thing? Will you write down before we go to the Word of God here for a few minutes? Have you written down April the 16th? Will you start right now talking to family and friends? That's Easter. I don't like to say Easter. That's Resurrection Sunday. And on Resurrection Sunday, I would sure love to see the first tables that are filled would be friends and family members that we have that don't go to church. That we could say, hey, will you come and sit at my table on Easter Sunday, that we could have Easter Sunday brunch together? Wouldn't you love to see those people first? Jesus said that the Holy Spirit would anoint us to be witnesses in Jerusalem, and then Judea, and then Samaria, then the uttermost parts of the earth. Let's start with our own Jerusalem, with what's closest to us. And let's. Wouldn't it be wonderful to see, we only have, I think, Don, how many tables do we set? 17 tables that we set. Let's see that the 17 tables will fill up with our people first. And wouldn't it also be a wonderful testimony that this room is jam-packed on Easter Sunday, that we're having to turn people away? And not that we want to turn people away, but that we can just have that kind of a witness of what the Lord's given us favor to do. Will you seek the Lord with us? And we'll be talking a lot about it. But will you write those three things down? That's February the 19th. And that's going to be April the 16th. And the letter is going to be forthcoming. Okay? If you have your Bibles, let's take them out and open now to Psalm 18 that we referred to a minute ago. Psalm 18. And let's look at two verses there in that portion of Scripture. The 18th Psalm, verses 34 and 35. If you haven't marked these in your Bibles yet, I sure hope that you will. Will you follow along? I'm reading from the King James. He teaches my hands to war, so the bow of steel is broken in mine arms. Thou hast also given me the shield of thy salvation, and thy right hand hath holden me up, and thy gentleness hath made me great. If your translation says teach, I hope that you'll write in there what it has in the New American Standard. He trains. The reason we're sharing that is because we've given one portion of Scripture, but let's put a marker here in Psalm 18, and let's look together, if we will, over in the book of Amos. excuse me, Joel, the last chapter, when we began this study, we claimed this as one of the verses. We looked at it again last Sunday night. Verse 9 of Joel chapter 3, proclaim ye this among the Gentiles, prepare war, wake up the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near, and let them come up. And here's what we've been sharing in our study. It's time for us to quit being taught. That's what our plowshares are. Let's beat our plowshares into swords. Let's get ready to go into battle. And what is the battle we're asking you to be a part of? To be intercessory missionaries. To become prayer warriors. I'm asking the Lord that the biggest service of the week will turn into Saturday night at 4 o'clock. And that's our prayer meeting. We are grateful and thankful to the Comptons for making Miracle Manor available to us, but I'm praying we're going to grow out of it. That we won't be able to have enough room, for the people that are going to show up that want to be prayer warriors. I believe the liberty and the victories that we're having on Sunday and the presence of the Lord that we're feeling is a direct result of people that are getting a hold of God on Saturdays for us. And if we agree to become intercessory missionaries, there's one thing I'm guaranteeing. It's not a negative statement, it's a positive statement. You're going to come under spiritual attack. Anytime that we want to make a stand for God in our family, if we want to make a stand for God at our job, we want to make a stand of God even in our church, you're going to come under an attack. That's what it says over in Isaiah 59. Can I just refresh us with this one more time before we get into the scripture? Just that we have a good foundation. Look where it talks about our being intercessors and the Lord looking for intercessors in this 59th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Here's where the Lord says he's looking for intercessory missionaries. It's in verse 16. And it says, and he saw there was no man and wondered that there was no intercessor. Therefore his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness, it sustained him. The Lord had to do it himself because he didn't find anybody that was willing to do it. But look what it says just before this verse about the Lord looking for intercessors. Verse 15 says, yea, truth faileth, and he that departeth from evil maketh himself a prey. Do you see that? He that departeth from evil, that's going to turn away from doing wrong and start doing what's right, you just made yourself a target. Made yourself a target for what? For the arrows of the enemy. That's what it says. Look back in Psalm 18 where we started. That 18th Psalm says we're to train, not just be taught. How many know there's a difference between being taught and getting trained? I'll never forget Anthony when he signed up in high school to be on the golf team. And he didn't have his driver's license yet. And he said, Dad, I got to be at school. What time do you have to be there in the morning? 5 o'clock for the golf team. Yeah, for what? I've seen great big, huge big people like this, totally out of shape, playing golf. He had to be at 5 o'clock, he said, for training. What did you have to do at 5 o'clock in the morning?
Run laps, lift weights. There was nothing golf about it. The exact reason I wanted to play golf was to avoid that stuff.
Signed up to play golf to avoid it. But you know what? What they were trained to do during those hours gave them the stamina to be able to go and do what was required of them, even on a golf course. The weightlifting's what built them up for being able to do their driving. and the stamina was to be able to play, because when they entered into tournaments, it wasn't just them playing 9 holes of golf or 18 holes of golf and being relaxing. It was under pressure of playing sometimes 36 holes and going out and playing 2 and 3 days in a row. And they didn't get to ride around on golf carts with their dad that drove them around. They had to walk every one of those. And they didn't have little carts that they got to have pulling along. They had to carry the bags. So how many know sometimes when there's training that may even seem a little ridiculous at the time, there'll come a moment when it's necessary and you wish you hadn't just been sitting around being taught, that you would have known what it was to be exercising yourself in the training. Now, what are the arrows, first of all? That's what we've been looking at for the past several weeks, and I hope you've got them written down, and with God's help, I'm not going to do any reviewing. First of all, we've looked at the first arrow is a lack of spiritual passion. The enemy will shoot that at us and try to rob us of our passion. How many know in the midst of where it says in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 24, all the signs about the last days, one of the things he said is the love of many will grow cold. What did he say to the church at Ephesus? That first church that the angel, the Spirit of the Lord, came through and brought a message in the book of Revelation. Get back to your first love. Here's number two. We find ourselves getting extremely annoyed and frustrated. That's not because you drank too much coffee. When all of a sudden we find it's an extreme that we're irritated about things, the enemy's trying to do all he can to shoot these arrows. Here's number three. He wants to confuse our purpose. How many know your job is not your purpose? Your job is your vocation to support your purpose. Here's number four. He'll shoot the arrow of a lack of peace. The book of Philippians has 4 chapters. When the Apostle Paul wrote, I don't believe he divided them into chapters. That came later. But I do believe it's rather convenient that in those 4 chapters, there come 4 things that can rob your joy. That's what that letter is written about. 16 times Paul will refer to joy. But how many know joy has a Siamese twin? Joy and peace. What do those 4 chapters say? Well, first of all, in chapter 1, he'll say circumstances. How many know their circumstances can rob your peace? And in chapter 2, he talks about people. How many know people can rob your joy and your peace? Maybe you've heard me say it before. My dad used to say, everybody brings joy. Some bring it wherever they go, and some bring it whenever they go. Chapter 3 in Philippians, the Apostle Paul wrote and said, I count all things but loss, that I could gain the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. How many know things can rob your peace and steal your joy? And the fourth, as the Apostle Paul wrote in chapter 4 and said, be anxious for nothing, but in all things, with prayer and supplication, make your requests known unto the Lord. How many know the enemy can bring anxiety? And it'll rob your joy and steal your peace. He can shoot that arrow and deflate peace in a heartbeat. Let's look at number 8. No. Number what? 5. I sure want to get to 8. How many know there can be unusual feelings of just being sluggish, just being tired? Watch how subtle this can be. Has he ever brought this on you, just saying, I think I just need to stay home tonight and rest, not go to church? Wow. Here's number 6. A strong feeling to quit. I shared this. The enemy's clever, boy. On the way to prayer meeting, on my way to prayer meeting, I'm not talking about earlier in the day. I'm not talking about while still in our home. I'm talking about riding in the car. My phone goes, and I, like a fool, picked it up. And it was a person on the other end with the audacity of saying, I just want you to know, you won't be seeing me in church anymore from now to March the 3rd. I'm not upset. I've not been offended. Just not going to be there. They even had the date. Not going to be there till March the 3rd. How many know? Man, I just wanted to skip prayer meeting and go over to their house and just say, you know what? Why don't you just keep that message to yourself and just don't show up till March the 3rd? Whatever was going on, the enemy wants to get us to quit. Can I just give this verse to you one more time? Will you write it down? Ecclesiastes 10 and verse 4 says, when the ruler's temper rises against you, don't abandon your position. Yes. Here's number 7. And this is the one we ended on last week, and then we'll give you the 8th arrow so we can get to the bows tonight before you leave. The arrows are what hit us, but how many know if you can get to the source of where they're coming from, now you're really going to get victory on the battlefield. What was number 7 that we gave you? That's when we have the temptation to be drawn back to old bondages. We gave you a verse in Hebrews 11 and verse 15 that said that if they had been thinking of the country from which they came, they would have had opportunity to return. How many know we can make hidden provisions for defeat in our life? We're not going to spend any more time on that because I want to get into number 8, this final arrow tonight. The final arrow is this, and that's when we question what was once clear in our spiritual life. Cammy and Tom are in Arizona right now visiting family, and I was hoping that Cammy would still be here by the time we got to this point, because I know she'll remember this very, very well. My ministry began with being the janitor at the church, and I was called into my dad's office. They had just started Christian Training Center, and my dad gave me the option of either teaching a class in CTC or cleaning toilets. How many know that took a long time to pray about? I didn't even have to pray about it. I immediately knew the Lord was opening a door and closing one. And the problem was they needed me to teach a cults class. And I didn't know what a cult was. I had to look at Dick Christensen, who was at that time the head of Christian Training Center, and I said, yeah, I teach the class. What is a cult? And they gave me a book by Dr. Walter Martin called Kingdom of the Cults. And that's how it began. Back then, I had an apartment, and the only furniture I had was a bed, a dresser, and a chair. And I sat in my apartment, I know it may shake you all up, smoking my pipe with my bottle of wine, reading my book. And I would go into class the next day, and I'd say to the students, okay, I can tell you everything about these 3 chapters, but if you want to know anything beyond these chapters, don't ask anything because I don't know. I haven't gotten that far yet. And during that year, God blessed, and I had several privileges. One of the privileges was I got to meet Dr. Walter Martin, and he became a very dear spiritual mentor to me. He was the one who wrote Kingdom of the Cults. And the Lord took that ministry I think those were the days that I first met Wayne Teicher, but I didn't know it because he was a police officer down on Main Street where there was the Cat's Meow and the She Club. And that's where my class went down on the street corner and we witnessed. And I could go on all night long about our street witnessing experiences that were down there. Isn't that right, Wayne? You were a police officer while we were doing that. And you weren't even coming to Calvary Temple yet, I don't think, were you? So during those days, the Lord opened the door for me to start going to churches and teach cults. And back in those days, churches would be filled with people when we taught on Jehovah's Witnesses or Mormonism or Christian Science. And, of course, they didn't think we were there anyway, so they never showed up. But if you don't know about Christian Science, you wouldn't understand that. And we would have debates. And sometimes those debates would become really, really heated in defending the faith. Well, during those days, Emil Robles was just starting his church in Newcastle, Pennsylvania. And when he started his church, he was deluged by people in Newcastle that were part of cults. And they were seeking to sabotage his church. And he heard about what I was doing back in Fort Wayne. And so he called me and said, "Will you come to my church and conduct a cult seminar?" And the only date that we could get worked out was while I was on vacation with Mom and Dad. And so I said, "Abel, all I've got are just these 2 days, and I'll come up there." And so during my vacation, I went, and I was there on a Sunday night, and we started teaching at 6 o'clock in his Sunday night service. And after he did all the preliminaries, they turned it to me around 6:30, and I was to teach for an hour. Well, we got done teaching for an hour, and the church was filled with Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses and a group at that time called the Way International that had come into his church. And while we were there, Abel said, "How many of you would like Phil to go another hour?" And so we taught for another hour. We went to 8 o'clock, a little after 8. And when we were done, he said, "How many want to open up for questions now for another hour?" We went to 9 o'clock until, let me just make this whole story short. We ended up with something that I'd never known before. We went to 11 o'clock that night, and nobody budged out of the church. Can you imagine being in church from 6 until 11 o'clock at night? We started the next morning. He said, "How many will come back if Phil's here?" We only got him for one day. "How many will be here at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning?" And at 9 o'clock the next morning, we started again, and the church was filled, except we weren't doing any teaching then. We were doing defense of the gospel of people that were trying to say they didn't believe that. They had their New World translations, and they had their Book of Mormons, and we had our Bible, and we just went back and forth and back and forth till noon. We went back at 2 o'clock until 5. And we came back at 7 o'clock, and we're there from 7 till 10 that night. It was the most incredible experience, and the Lord let a revival break out. That's how Abel and I became really connected as dear friends. And then their church started coming to our camp, and we had a wonderful relationship that was born out of that revival. When I was done that night, and the next morning was going to fly back to be with my parents in Florida, Abel dropped me off at my room. And when I went back to my room, I laid down on the bed, and I was exhausted. I was too tired to even take my clothes off. And I was just laying there on the bed. All of a sudden, it swept over me. The Trinity isn't real. And all of a sudden, I began to totally doubt what I had just spent a whole night and day and night defending with all the energy that I had, that within the nature of one God, there are three eternal persons, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three persons are one God, and had fought it against Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses and the Way International and showed scripture for it. And as I laid there, I was tormented to death and went back to Florida and didn't say anything. When I got back from vacation, there was a guy named Jerry Miller. Do you remember Jerry Miller? He was the one that wrote the juicy news for the Adam's apple. I had never spent 1 minute with him. And when I got back into town, my first day in the office, he came into my office and he said, "Can I take you to lunch?" Anybody's going to buy my lunch, I was game for it. And I went to lunch with him. And when we sat down, we were at the Ayers Tea Room downtown. And he handed me a book. And it was by a man named C.S. Lewis. And the book was entitled Mere Christianity. And in that book, he'd underlined something. And he said, "Phil, while you were gone on vacation, I don't know what you were doing, but the Lord laid on my heart to pray for you. And what he told me to pray for you about was from this book." And he said, "You were on vacation. It just seemed so ridiculous," he said, "that you were on vacation and I was praying this for you. And in the book, I memorized it. It's still in my heart." And here's what C.S. Lewis said in Mere Christianity: "There is no doctrine that is any greater call to question than the one you have just most vigorously defended." And he said, I don't know why. And I looked at him, I said, "Jerry, while I was on vacation, I went and I told him what I experienced. Nobody had known I was there but Cammie. And she hadn't, I asked her, she hadn't told anybody. But the Lord had laid on somebody else's heart the burden to pray for somebody else about something. Because you want to know one of the arrows the enemy wants to shoot at believers? He wants to question what once was clear to us. When we begin praying, I'm not going to try to program this into you. I'm just going to tell you what mine were. I've known what it is to start praying, and while I'm praying in tongues going, that is just gibberish. And I've been doing that. I've been praying in tongues since I was 14 years old. It's the first time I've ever in my life ever had even that thought that would come across my mind. I've known what it is to go looking at television and seeing different shots in commercials of crowds and seeing those great big crowds and going, how can there be all these people and God be hearing Phil Pano's prayer in Fort Wayne? Have you ever had any of these kind of things that all of a sudden in your mind get crazy that are there? You know what that is? It's the enemy that's wanting to come with an arrow to say, now I want to take what you have just most vigorously believed, and I want to twist it and distort it. Will you write down these verses? 1 Peter 3:15. "But sanctify the Lord God in your heart, and be ready always to give an answer to every man for the hope that lies within you." I want you to hear the verse carefully. It didn't say, be ready to give an answer first. It said, but sanctify the Lord God in your heart, and be ready always to give an answer. If we don't do that first, then all we will do is get head knowledge without heart knowledge. This is not a textbook that we study. It says in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12, it's alive. When we read this book, we're having a relationship with it. When all of a sudden it becomes academic, now the enemy can come on an academic level and bring questions about it. But when it's a relationship, then it becomes like that song we sing regretfully only at Easter. He lives, he lives, he lives. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives in my heart. There are so many saints that don't have a relationship with the book where it speaks to us. It's talking to us. When we have a relationship with somebody, now you can do what it says in Jude verse 3. "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you concerning this common salvation, it was necessary for me to exhort you to put up a stiff fight for the faith which has been once and for all delivered unto the saints." Whew. Who's that stiff fight with? unbelievers, well, sometimes. But sometimes it can be with the arrows the enemy's wanting to shoot at us. To doubt these things. He can bring a doubt that we can... Let me show you how this doubt's manifested. I'm not asking you to raise a hand or put you on the spot. But how many, I wonder, since we first presented 46802, have known what it is to get on your knees alone with God and pray over those souls? I wonder how many of us, that when we first talked about it and we picked up the sheets of paper that had the zones that we could take, how many have taken the time just to get in your car and drive through it? Do you know that when we don't do just those simple little things, it really becomes an evidence of our unbelief that it can do anything? I know that's a heavy note to end on. That's the last of the arrows that we're going to look at. Next week, we'll look at the bows, where they're shot from. Because doesn't it say in Psalm 18 that not only are we to deal with the arrows, but it says our arms are strong enough to break the bows of where they're coming from. And that's where we'll look next week. Well, let's get home. We got chicken wings waiting. Can we stand together, please?